Have you had an encounter with Mr. Tall, Dark, and Scary, and would you like to hear it narrated on this channel? Well, if so, send me an email with all the details. You can send it to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hey there, everyone. Welcome or welcome back, whatever the case may be. Welcome or welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. It's been pretty stormy and wild here today in Southwest Ohio, so I'm so glad you could make it. Now, tonight's story is taking place in Montana, where a young woman alone finds that a Sasquatch is following her, possibly for an unsettling reason. Are you ready? Me too. I know the horses are ready. Let's go. My story is a strange one, but it is not the only one like it that I've heard since I started researching and listening to other stories about Bigfoot encounters. Now, I hate to say it, but some of the details, well, they're a little TMI, too much information, you know, but I really have no choice but to include them. During the pandemic, I lost my bartending job at a national restaurant chain. But don't worry, it wasn't as bad as it might sound. It was really kind of a relief for me. I had never liked the job, and I had a substantial savings, so I thought about it, and I decided to go ahead and pursue at least part of a dream that I had begun with a previous boyfriend. I decided to not renew my lease when it was up in 2 months' time, sold most of what I had, and decided to hit the open road. I had a 1994 Ford Econoline 350 cargo van that had been languishing at my parents' house for almost 2 years. I had bought that van when a previous boyfriend and I were dreaming about doing the whole tiny house living thing, but on wheels. He was very handy, and we had already mapped out exactly how to convert that van to live in it. The Econoline that I had was the cargo type. It only had windows on the back doors, the front windshield, and there was one roll-down window on each side up front. But the main body of the van was solid metal, no windows. When I took over living in it, it was not a finished interior. We had pulled most of it out and were preparing to do work, so it was pretty bare. But I had an air mattress that fit, the bedding I needed, a cooler and a few totes to keep my things in. No fancy kitchenette like we had planned out. There was no propane refrigerator. My cooking was limited to a camp stove with fuel canisters, or I could make a wood fire outside. However, I rarely did much more than heat up food or make a salad, and I tended to stop in towns and buy things to eat every day or so when I needed more ice for the cooler, and sometimes I would stop for a hot meal in town. The thing is, I intentionally did not want to keep much food in the van. My plan was simple and basic. In the winter, stay to the south. In the summer, head north. And that worked really good for 2020 and 2021. During that time, I often spent much of my day looking for somewhere to park that night, as many parks and campgrounds were closed for COVID. As a lone woman traveling, I was very cautious and particular about where I would park for the night. In 2022, it was a welcome change when many of the previously closed places were now beginning to open up. In August of that year, I stopped at the Musick Road Campground in Montana. This is in the Bitterroots. The camp is a mix of tent and vehicle types, and there's a good road in, and the campground is in a loop, and just beyond there is a large lake, and everything else is heavily forested. The area is covered in many types of trees. I know most people can identify and name trees, but I'm lucky to tell a pine from an oak. I do know that one has needles and one has leaves, but that's about it. I got settled in and did a walk out to the lake. Then I walked along the shore toward the west, where I found another large opening area. I walked and explored through there, and then walked through the forest until I came to an unexpected opening with a pond. My GPS on my Fitbit watch showed that I was barely southwest of the campground, less than a quarter of a mile. I made it a habit to walk the areas around where I camped, if it was out in nature. First, it was good exercise for me. Secondly, it was a good excuse to get out of that van. And thirdly, it didn't cost me anything to do. I also liked being aware of what was around wherever I was staying for the night. I had walked through the trees and came out to a clearing around the pond. I was on the north side of it, and I began to walk down the west side of the pond heading south. I intended to make a full loop around it. While walking through the trees from the lake to that pond, I had had a sensation of hot flushes on the front of my neck and face, and a prickling along the back of my neck. It was the same sensation that I had when I was in school, and I knew a bunch of those mean girls were staring at me and talking about me. I knew someone was looking at me out there, but as much as I looked around, I didn't see anyone. But because of that feeling, I kept looking around, and I kept looking back at the north end of the pond. I pulled up the GPS on my Fitbit, and I saw, as I said, I was now less than 1,000 feet to the west of my camp area. I was halfway around the pond, so I continued to walk this shore where I could, and then had to step along the trees inside when I had to, because they grew out to the edge of the pond. I was feeling a little nervous, but I told myself it was probably just another camper doing what I was, and it was nothing to be concerned about. Now, even though COVID was mostly old news, I had noticed that many of the habits adopted during that time were still being practiced by many people, even in the wilderness. People would often stop and let more distance lapse between them and someone else on the trail ahead of them if they saw them. I also thought maybe those people were waiting for me to leave the area so they could take a picture of the pond. I thought of 1,000 normal reasons someone else might be out there like that. But as I came around toward the south side of the pond, it had a curve that made it easy and natural for me to look back to where I had come out of the trees on the north side, where I had started from. I looked, and I saw someone standing very still by the trees on the north side. It was maybe about 5 or 6 p.m., but the sun was now decidedly on the left side to the west. So I held up my hand to my brow to shade my left side so I could see. The person stood completely still. They were far enough away that I couldn't see a lot of detail. I did note that they were wearing some kind of all-over brown apparel. Most hikers wear brighter colors somewhere on them so they can be seen, but not this person. Everything they had on was a dark reddish brown. I presumed it was matching joggers and a sweatshirt. From that distance, it was really hard to make out with the sun coming strong from the left. And while everything else was brightly lit up, they were not. They were stepped back just enough to be shielded from the sun, yet still be visible. I waited a second, and I lifted my right arm and vigorously waved. Then I yelled out a very friendly hello that went very smoothly right over the top of the pond. As soon as I yelled out my friendly hello, the person stepped backwards quickly, then turned and began to walk further to the west. Something in my stomach dropped. I still can't define what it was about that moment or about their action, but the prickling at the back of my neck intensified. I was overcome with feelings of caution and alarm, but I didn't know why exactly. But I had always been told to trust my gut feelings, and they were telling me to be on alert. At that point, I was still working under the assumption that I was dealing with a human. I had no reason, other than the monotone color that I saw, to think otherwise. And generally, it was humans that were the most troublesome out there. I tracked it as it walked within the trees. I followed it until it stopped about 50 feet from where it had been, which is where I had stepped out of the trees into the clearing by the pond. When it stopped, it positioned itself so that it was mostly hidden behind trees, but I could see it was turned my way. I knew it was still looking right at me. I was at almost the southern end of the pond where it begins to go back around. Call it the halfway point. The thing to note here is that until that point, I was able to lightly skirt the entire pond shore, or only thread my way along one or two trees deep from the shore. But at the far southern end, I was dismayed to see that I had no choice but to go deeper into the trees away from the pond's edge in order to continue my way around. The trees had come out to the shore so thick you couldn't walk there. Normally, this would not bother me to go deeper in the trees, but I was very aware that I did not know this area. And that other person, they might. I might be being outflanked right now. They also might have an accomplice waiting in those trees somewhere ahead. I had a lot of thoughts of that nature going through my head. As a lone woman traveling, I'm always on alert. I made a quick decision to go ahead and forge onward. I reminded myself that I had bear spray with me, and I was pretty sure bear spray would reduce any man to a liquid puddle on the forest floor. I went deep into the trees at the south end, and I started hauling butt through there. I was keeping an eye on the GPS on my Fitbit to help navigate back to the camp area, which wasn't that far away. In my mind, I had plenty of distance between me and whoever that was back there. There was no way they could catch up to me. But when I went into the trees, I heard a strange grunting huff sound and a chortling noise. It sounded very much like a gorilla running to me, like it was expelling air out of its lungs forcefully with every step. I don't mean that it was an aggressive sound. It was maybe more the rushing sound from running. Or maybe it was more of an alarmed sound, like it was not happy it lost sight of me. Or maybe it was warning an accomplice ahead. And that's when I realized I wasn't necessarily thinking of it as a person, but as something else, perhaps an animal, perhaps not. I'm not sure when that shift began to happen, but I noticed it right then when it made that sound. And I was very wrong about the distance, that it probably couldn't catch up to me, because within a minute, I was hearing branches breaking right behind me, and the sound of footfalls thudding on the ground were very clear. I looked back, but I didn't see it. But I did hear that gruff, coarse huffing, like air being forced out of the lungs with every step, all over again. I looked behind several times, but I never saw my pursuer at that point. I had to cross a creek, but it didn't slow me down at all. I don't think I slowed down until I got to the camp area and got in my van. I was shaking and on the edge of hyperventilating. I sat there, expecting to feel something hit the van at any second. But minutes ticked by, and I heard nothing but other people around the camp area. Once I calmed down, I had a laugh at myself, and I convinced myself that I had just seen a bear that was just standing up, looking at me from across the pond, a bear that, against all odds, I somehow outran. Yeah, that was it, I told myself. I was being so silly. And so I convinced myself to stay right where I was. In a half hour, I went out and set up my camp stove outside, and I made myself a quick dinner of just a can of Dinty Moore beef stew and toasted some dry bread to soak up all those juices. Hey, don't knock it till you try it. But while I was eating, that prickling feeling on the back of my neck started to come back. I was almost done eating, but I decided to quickly pick up my bowl and my toast, and I put them inside the van. I got inside, closed it up, and then I finished eating. I slipped my dirty bowl into a Ziploc bag to wash out in the morning. No way I was going back outside. All that evening, I went back and forth in my mind between telling myself it was just a bear and that I was being silly, and then thinking something made it feel very much like not a bear, like something else was happening. Or had happened, or might happen, and that maybe I would be best to just hit the road. And then I would go back to feeling foolish all over again, And that's how it went in complete cycles all evening until I went to sleep. When I was almost asleep, I heard the strangest sound out in the forest. It was loud enough and strange enough that I sat up on my air mattress at the back of the van. I pushed a curtain aside and looked out the back window. It was kind of like an owl hoot, but it was just one hoot, and it was long and drawn out. Then it would wind down and start all over again. After this, I went and listened to as many recordings of owls as I could find on the internet, and I have not found one at all like what I heard. I could see nothing out the back window, though. There was just deep blackness. These sounds unnerved me, and it went on for about half an hour in different cycles. After it got quiet again for a while, I double-checked all the van locks, checked all the window coverings again, and I finally fell into a deep sleep. But sometime during the night, I came awake. I thought I heard something outside the van. Once, it felt like the van was maybe bumped by something, but I wasn't sure. Half asleep, I convinced myself it was just raccoons checking out crumbs out there from where I ate, and it had probably just knocked over the camp stove on the little table. And I had left both the table and the camp stove out there when I came inside the van in haste earlier. Yeah, that was it, I said. I heard it, and sleepily had my reasoned out thoughts of what it was, and went back to sleep. There must have been a light rain overnight, because when I woke up, everything was misty and damp outside. I took my coverings down in the front windows, and I was surprised to see that someone had pulled in with a very big camper just one spot down from me. I don't think they were there when I went to sleep, so I indeed must have slept very soundly. I got out of the van, picked up the stove and the table, and set them upright. As I did so, I noticed very large tracks all around the van in the soft earth. At first glance, I was sure it was a bear, and that it told me that it wasn't some raccoon that I had heard in the middle of the night. I was puzzled because there was no food out there to draw anything. I hadn't left any garbage either. What food I had was consumed in its entirety the night before. As I said, I tend to stop and buy what I'm going to eat almost every day. I don't carry food for a lot of reasons. I have to confess something here again, and that is that sometime the evening before, the idea that it could have been a Sasquatch did cross my mind, but I rejected it as soon as I thought of it. I was a reasonable person, I told myself. I'm not given to fits of imagination. And Sasquatches? Well, they were firmly in the realm of imagination. But what I saw around my van was undeniable. And no matter how I tried, I didn't really think it was a bear print I was seeing. There were very distinct toes, not claws. I'd seen bear tracks in my previous 2 years of visiting probably hundreds of places, and I had seen one bear, luckily at a great distance. And none of those times did the back of my neck prickle, and my face and the front of my neck did not flush or get hot and prickly like they were last night and right then. This had a very different feel to it. What drew the Sasquatch near me, the van, or the campground? Well, I'm not 100% certain, but I do have a very strong suspicion, and I will share it with you before the end of my story. But now is not the time. At the risk of upsetting my new neighbors, I walked over and around the back of their camper. They weren't up or about yet, and if they saw me, I had a story prepared to tell them about why I was over there. But no one came out. I looked carefully. There were no tracks around their area. The only tracks I had seen at all were around my camp area and my van. I also saw handprints on the front windshield. They weren't real clear. They were kind of smeared. But it looked like someone had leaned up against the van and cupped two very, very large hands against the glass, trying to see in. Now, this brings up a host of other issues and questions, but I'll get to those later. For now, I'm realizing bear, man, Sasquatch, whatever it was, it had walked around my van as I slept. I'm kicking myself for not at least looking outside when I heard something in the middle of the night. But then again, maybe it's best I didn't look. I headed on down from there to the camp toilets and took care of some lady business. Then I fast walked back towards my van. As I passed my new neighbors, I was looking toward my van, and I caught movement behind my van in the trees. I stopped and I focused on the shape that I had just seen move. It was very much like what I had seen the day before. The prickling on the back of my neck was back, accompanied by some stomach churning. I never leave my van without bear spray, and I did have it on me. So, with a faltering step, I continued forward, but I made sure the safety cap was flipped off on the spray. I have a dilemma here about how much to actually tell you. I told you that I believed I had an idea of why it had followed me, why it had circled my van and nobody else's. And that reason is because it was my time of the month. Now, that only came to mind after I realized this is not a human out there. I had just been to the toilets, as I said. I did what women have to do, and then I washed as well as I could with a bottle of water and what I call soap slurry that I carry. The soap slurry is like a body wash that I dilute in a 1-to-4 or 1-to-5 ratio with real good water to thin it down. It makes it easier to use, and it's much easier to rinse and clean up when you have very little water. I had also changed undergarments while there, so I was carrying the used undergarment back in a bag with my other things. And let me stress without being graphic, the undergarment was not dirtied up, if you catch my drift. It was still very clean. I'm sorry to have to tell these details, but I think if I don't, it won't make much sense. Right then I had the idea that if this was a Sasquatch, it was singling me out because it was my time of the month, like it could smell it. I didn't think it wanted to mate exactly. I think maybe it was just a confusing smell. Maybe it found that scent with something else I was wearing, like my body wash or the body spray. Maybe it found it interesting. I don't want to make the assumption that it was interested for, shall we say, an unnerving reason. But that is the only oddity that I think set me and my van and my area apart from everyone else. The shape I saw was hovering between a few trees about 20 feet behind my camping area. I saw it lift its head, and though I couldn't hear it, I think it was sniffing the air. Then I saw its mouth open. There was a gape with pink and gray inside blurry, with ivory teeth in the midst of all that brown fur. It was like a cat that sniffs a dirty sock. Their nose wrinkles up, and they open their mouth while inhaling. I angled my walk to keep an eye on the shape as I got closer to my van. As I got closer, I saw it much more clearly. When most people describe a Sasquatch, they talk about its height and how big it is. I'm not saying this one wasn't big, but I put it in the 6.5-foot category of height. It might have been even less. It seemed very rounded and thick. Its head appeared more round in shape. There was a slant upward, yes, but the overall shape was very round. But that round face, it was that face, those dark eyes, they were like black marble stuck in its face. The shoulders were rounded, and they rolled forward on the torso. The skull sat down low on the chest, and that was also rounded like a big barrel. The arms were very long, almost to the knees. What I was looking at was not one of those powerful but slender Sasquatches everyone talks about. I once dated a guy who went on to be an offensive linebacker in the NFL. He was in the 340 to 350 pound range. If they had stood together, my ex would have looked like a puny nothing compared to that Sasquatch. Its face was expressionless, but that made it seem more dangerous to me somehow. It was focused on me, and my skin was crawling. I saw it react slightly when the alarm on my van chirped when I unlocked it with the key fob as I got close to the driver's door. Now this next bit will probably sound irrational to some of you, but I realized it had stayed around all night. It had been all around my van. It followed me yesterday, and the only reason that came to me was my time of the month. Right before I got into the van, I threw, as hard as I could, the plastic grocery bag that was tied up with all of my things in it. I threw it as far as I could, and it landed in the dirt, about halfway between my van and the Sasquatch. I guess the irrational thought going through my head was, maybe this way it wouldn't follow me. I mean, it probably couldn't follow me across the state at the speed my van could go, but I didn't think I wanted to take any chances. I saw it look at what I threw, and then it looked right back at me. It started that breathing through the mouth thing again. That gave me the heebie-jeebies, something terrible. I got in my van as fast as I could. I got it started, and I tore out of there. I realized only later I had left my small fold-out table and my little camp stove behind. I didn't care. Now, about the handprints that I mentioned on the windshield. Here's the things that just didn't make sense to me about it. I have fitted curtains and covers that fit exactly in all of my windows. They were custom-made. They provide a total blackout and total privacy. So what made it even try to look in? How did it know to do that with a windshield when it just must have looked black with all the blackout up against it? I mean, everything would have been black, especially in the middle of the night. Your guess is as good as mine on those things. I have stopped and overnighted in a million campgrounds and parks, and I've done a lot of boondocking and stealth camping. I have never had any serious issues other than with one weird man. Mostly, it's a free life that I have learned to sustain while on the road with creating digital content, thrifting and reselling, and several other ways of creating income. This has not stopped me from living my freedom life. I know someday I'll have to give it up, but I have no plans for that anytime soon. However, I do avoid that entire area of Montana, just as a precaution. Most people think the idea that it was following my monthly scent is ridiculous. The truth is, I thought it was too, until I started reading up on it after this event. I have heard other stories on YouTube, which made me think, why not go ahead and tell my story? Now, I didn't get up close and personal with Mr. Tall, Dark, and Scary like you say before your videos. But trust me, it was close enough for me. I never want to be that close again. And if I haven't said so before, I am certain this Sasquatch was male for 100 different reasons, and some of them I am not going to explicitly state. But the savvy among you can probably guess what I might have seen as I went toward my van. Now thank you for getting to the end of this long email, if you did. It was hard going to get to the things I needed to say about it. Anyway, thank you again. Signed, Heather Simpson, originally from Columbus, Ohio. All right, well, thank you for your story, Heather. And you are right. There are other stories that seem to have a Sasquatch focusing on a female with a monthly cycle. Now, what the intent or purpose is, I don't want to speculate. We're getting into like National Examiner or National Enquirer range when we get into all that. You know, running into a Sasquatch is scary enough. I don't want to think about the other motives that could be going on here. So anyway, I just want to say thank you for staying with me to the end tonight, people. And we made it to Sasquatch Valley and back tonight. And incredibly, we didn't lose anyone along the way. I would call that a success. So, well, you know, we're going to be getting together again real soon. And until we do, I want you to always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.